probably the reason for my success in making it through this career was balance.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to episode 11 of The Squad Room. I'm your host, Garrett Teslaw. I'm an active duty police sergeant here in Southern California. This is an introduction to the introduction of sorts, and I have a couple things for you. First thing, one, please stop what you're doing and go to iTunes or open your browser and go to iTunes and leave us a review on the podcast page. What you have to do is you have to search for The Squad Room, and you can leave us a review right there. Give us an honest review. Give us your feedback, but we'd appreciate it. As a listener of podcasts, the purposes of reviews are sort of obvious, but also limited. But as the producer of a podcast, they are extremely beneficial in helping us get some exposure on iTunes and some attention, and also help validate to some potential guests that what we're doing is valuable to the audience. And I know it is because I keep hearing from all of you. That brings up point number two. If you're enjoying this and you have a topic that you'd like us to cover or a guest that you think we should have on, please email me at squadroompodcast@gmail.com. That's pretty simple. squadroompodcast@gmail.com. Thanks for listening. Last bit, I will introduce the guest here in the introduction. This is the introduction to the introduction. But he is Ed Aceves, but his current job is working with RX Smart Gear, the maker of those pretty cool jump ropes. I have one at home. I've had one for about 18 months or so, 2 years, and I love it. And it's the only thing that's helped me get even remotely close to being able to accomplish double unders. I learned that the Rogue speed ropes or any of those speed ropes were way too light for me. I needed something with a bit more whip to it, and the RX company came through, and they make a great product. They're not a sponsor of this show. They didn't sponsor this episode. They're not doing anything long-term for us, but what they are doing is offering 15% off jump ropes for listeners of The Squad Room because today's guest is their law enforcement liaison, and I thought that was pretty cool. So if you go over to rxsmartgear.com and you enter the code SQUADROOM15, that's Squad Room, all in caps, and 15, 1-5, you'll get 15% off your order. And that's pretty cool. Lastly, I also want to, again, thank Jeff over at Fresh Tracks Designs for hooking us up with that awesome Squad Room logo. If you or your union need T-shirts or a logo or some promotional work done, or you got a little side gig going, check him out, Fresh Tracks, T-R-A-X, design.com. He'll hook you up. He's a good dude, and he's a wicked CrossFitter. All right. Anyway, thank you, everybody, for listening, and on to the episode. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to episode 11 of The Squad Room. I'm your host, Garrett Teslaw. I'm a police sergeant with a sheriff's department in Southern California. And if this is your first listening of our podcast, I encourage you to go back to episode 1 and you'll hear more about what we're trying to accomplish. Short version of it is this is a podcast that's devoted to optimizing the health, fitness, and wellness of peace officers, corrections, and first responders all over, all over the world, but mostly we talk to people here in the United States. There's three aspects to that. One is a documentary or a journaling of my journey back to fitness and getting healthy again, and also talking and interviewing subject matter experts like we did in the last episode with Dr. Kirk Parsley and Dr. Fay and Dr. Goodman and many others. And then the third aspect of that, or the third trifecta of this idea, is what we have today, which is talking with other police officers, both active duty and retired, who have been successful in their careers and successful in maintaining their fitness through their career. So today's guest is Ed Aceves. He is the former police chief for La Mesa Police Department in Southern California in San Diego County. He has over 30 years of law enforcement experience, and I'll let him go through his resume real quick for you. But Ed, welcome.
Thank you, Garrett. Appreciate it.
Yeah, it's. I'm glad this worked out. We'll jump to your new job here in a little bit, but okay. I saw an Instagram post with you in it a couple months ago,
right.
And dug a little bit and found your email and thought, coupled with your experience and what you do now, you'd be a perfect guest. And we exchanged some emails, and lo and behold, you were coming through town just at the right time. So thanks for being here.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
So I mentioned you were the former chief of police of La Mesa PD.
Correct.
Can you maybe walk us through what your career path was, what you've done or what you did?
Sure.
Did you spend all that time at La Mesa? And
I did. Actually, I started in La Mesa as an intern back in 1982 and then worked as a reserve officer for a year and then was hired full time at the end of 85, beginning of 86. And there ever since, did a lot of the same stuff that everyone does, you know, work patrols and FTO, traffic, investigations, worked in the schools, which was a great experience. Then sergeant in 97, and as a sergeant, did patrol for a few years and then went into a little stint as a traffic sergeant. And then lieutenant in 2002 and did that for 4 years and then made captain in 2005 and did that for 6 years and then became chief in 2011. And then just recently retired, as you mentioned, about 4 months ago. So this is my new career of not working. So
how's that going so far?
So far, it's been way too easy. So I'm a little scared about that. It's been great doing a lot of traveling and kind of reconnecting both with family and friends that, as all of you know, the job kind of steals from us sometimes. Mm-hmm. And so it's been really a great first few months.
You even got to spend last week at the CrossFit Games, didn't you?
I did. Yeah. Actually, I just went up on Sunday, and it was the first time I've actually ever been there. I went to the California Regionals in May, and first time I'd done that. And what an amazing experience. I mean, it, not to mention I was the oldest one probably in the stadium. it's a very young person's game at this point with mm-hmm. The athletes, but, what an amazing experience.
Yeah. And La Mesa, just for people who don't know that area, it's in San Diego County.
Correct. Right? It's about 10 square miles. We have 100 employees, about 70 officers, 30, non-sworn. And it's right next to San Diego State University. We actually work with them quite a bit when anyone needs help, I guess, either them or us, and border San Diego PD on two sides of our city and sheriffs and Alcohol PD on the other side. So it's a nice community, has its share of issues, mostly property-related crime, but it was a great place to work.
Yeah. And San Diego is never a bad place.
No, that's true. That's true. And I kind of a unique thing for me is I was born and raised in La Mesa. And so it's kind of was unique that I was able to not only stay there, but become the police chief there and went to Helix High School, which I'm sure wasn't famous for me, but Bill Walton, Alex Smith, Reggie Bush all went to this. They went to my high school.
Yeah. So. Don't sell yourself too short. You went there too, right? So, we talked a little bit on the phone, and we talked a little bit by email, but your new job is with RX Smart Gear, which is mostly a jump rope. They're known for jump ropes, and that's what they do now. So what struck me about your transition was you obviously have an emphasis that or a, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but a passion for fitness. This is a hard career, and you did over 30 years.
Right.
How did you maintain a priority on fitness, or did you? Maybe that's even a better question. Is were there times where for fitness lagged and you had to seek it back, or did you always maintain a priority on your fitness, and how did you do that?
So clarify one thing. Work is probably probably not the right word. I don't work. I do some work for RX, but fitness is absolutely key. The owner of RX Smart Gear, Dave Newman, has been a longtime friend. I started at a CrossFit gym with him 7 years ago when he made one of his first ropes. And so he had asked me through the years if I'd be interested in coming and help teach for him and do some training. And it's always been, you know, fitness has always for me been absolutely a passion. I started when I was 14 years old, and I'm not sure, I was trying to think about this on the way up here. I don't think I've missed more than a week since I was 14. I mean, it's just one of those things that in our profession, I've always felt is probably one of the most important, more important than shooting, more important than driving, is our physical fitness, because it is really what keeps us alive more than anything else. And so I've always been big into not only fitness, but in defensive tactics and martial arts. And so to me, it's been one of those things that I think has been key for me to successfully navigate through this career, not only physically and to come out at the end with really relatively few injuries, but also mentally as well, to keep kind of the mental game sharp through my career. Regardless of what position I was in, it always helped.
What was it about when you started at 14? Were you really pushed into athletics, or did you find it by yourself, or was it just this?
I played a little bit of baseball, but all my very good friends played football in high school, and I was one of those kids that my dad did not let me play football because he blew out two knees when he was in high school, and so he put the law down that I was not playing football.
So, same for me, yeah.
So all my buddies were playing, so I started actually in the summer of my freshman year working out in the gym with them, and just totally got hooked then, and never stopped. And so I, you know, just love the way it made me, you know, feel as I was growing up and health, and was, you know, always fairly strong, and it was just enjoyable. It was a good escape for whatever I was in at the time.
Mm-hmm. At La Mesa, did you guys have, or do they have, a either wellness program or a physical ability test that you have to pass?
So we have both, actually.
Really?
We have a physical fitness program, but it's a voluntary program. So we use the FBI standards, so the mile and a half run, the flexibility, sit-ups, push-ups, the stretch and reach. And so each one of those is categorized by points. And if you get, I think 40 is the top level. And if you get 35 to 40, we give the employee 10 hours of leave time off. And so you do this every quarter, so you can get a week off, free week a year.
Wow.
What shocked me early on in my career when I was an officer, because we've had this program for a long time, and how few people participated. I mean, we would go through some quarters where six people would go through the fit test. And I'm like, it's a free week of time off, which we all love in this job. And so it really, as I started moving up in the ranks, the ironic thing is it doesn't apply to management. So I just did it for free from lieutenant on, but absolutely loved doing it. But it was always a key of how do we get more people involved? Because it benefits the agency and it benefits, obviously, the individual. And so that was really a tough thing to do. One of the things that helped us in 2010, we moved into a brand new building with state-of-the-art equipment, all brand new. The city bought it all. And that really increased not only participation in the gym, but also for people and our employees to then realize, wow, I can get some free time. So, and we picked up a lot of different coaches to kind of, officers that are coaches, to help everybody navigate through that program. And I think now we probably have 25 that on a regular basis participate, which is, I think, is a great thing.
It's about 30% of your sworn staff there,
correct?
Right?
Yeah. And I've always been shocked why it's not 100%. I mean, it's free time off. Because you even get points if you just show up and don't do well.
Yeah.
You know? So, but
it's hard to get cops to do anything.
Yes, very true.
Even when it's free.
Very true.
So, 30 years, I always like talking with retired guys who've got some perspective on the long view. I'm 10 years in, and I don't see I don't see that.
Sure.
And just yet, not yet, but, you know, it's coming up. What were your keys to a successful career, but also just completing it successfully? Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
The difference?
I would say my goals and probably the reason for my success in making it through this career was balance. And that's balance of work life, family life, and other life, whatever that happens to be. And you have to have hobbies. You have to have things that you enjoy doing. And I've seen it over and over with those in this profession that don't have the third component. Typically, if you don't have the third, usually there's a mix of, you know, one of them's too much, one of either the work life or home life. But you have to have something that you love to do, the passion, whether it's, you know, I love playing softball, I love playing golf, working out. And the family life is balancing all of that with what you want to do and what your goals are with work. And so I've always been good at that. My wife has made me good at that, and she's made me better through the years. We've just celebrated our 25th wedding anniversary. So
congratulations.
Thank you. That was a, you know, a huge thing in this profession. It's, you know, I truly believe that it's that balance that helped me along the way, because not only, as I mentioned earlier, as you're working with, you know, physically trying to make it through the career, but, you know, mentally and emotionally is just as important as you navigate through this profession.
Yeah. And I think that's one reason I was excited to talk to you, is because I have perspective from being a line officer to now a sergeant, but it seems to me that as you go, it doesn't get any easier in terms of the mental acuity that's required, but also the mental fatigue that can occur to you. I mean, you were a chief, and I'm sure you've gotten, I know you've gotten the, you know, the late night phone calls, right, and the everyone's looking to you for the decision. And if you're not if you're not ready, that makes life a lot harder.
Yeah, you know, I used, so I got into CrossFit about 7 years ago, and it was a great escape for whatever I was doing at the time, to just, because you can't think, you can't count, yeah, you can't do anything, right?
Can't breathe sometimes.
Exactly. And so as the chief, I would always, my goal was 4 times a week to make time, whether it was a 5 a.m. class, I'd go do it at lunchtime, or after work. My goal was I had to do it, because that was my one escape where I couldn't think about work for an hour. And it really, I will have to say, in the 3.5 years that I was chief, I was pretty much on target with at least, sometimes it was 3 times a week, but in a lot of times it just depended on what it was. You know, I had a, you have great plans, as we all do as cops, right? Oh, I'm going to work out at noon today, and then all hell breaks loose, and you don't go in at noon. But it was one of my goals, and I knew that it was in my best interest, and quite frankly, my employees' best interest, that I had that time away to then, when I was at work, to, you know, fully be immersed and work on that. So
you just said something really interesting. Can you maybe expand on that, about sure, how in your employees' best interest?
Yeah, you know, I mean, any supervisor, administrator, police chief, does not matter. When you're at work, you really need to be all in. And that's all in with, you know, not kind of the family issues, all the things that occur outside of our job that really kind of bring us down. I was a huge believer in, when I go to work, my employees should not know if I'm having a bad day, if I have an issue at home. And so you have to put that face on. And part of that is that mental toughness, I believe is what it is, to not let that stuff drag you down. And I think it's in their best interest to be led by, again, supervisors or managers that, you know, it's, we used to joke with some employees that, oh, it's a red flag day, don't, you know, don't bother Joe. Mm-hmm. And that's not the way, you know, you want to be supervised, and that's not the way you should be supervising. And so I always believe that, you know, being mentally fit when you showed up to work meant that you were all in, and it was about what you were doing for the employees, not, it's not about you.
Do you see a direct correlation between physical fitness and mental fitness, or do you think there's separate issues that have to be addressed separately?
I think a little bit of both, quite frankly. I think the physical fitness part, and that's why I really fell in love with CrossFit, because it helped me with the mental part of it, the mental toughness part of, you know, my livelihood, because there are times in the gym where you don't think you can finish a workout, and then you tell yourself you can't quit. I mean, we can't quit if we're in a bad fight in the streets, or, you know, whatever the situation may be. And so I do think that it helps build mental toughness. I think if we're talking mental as far as mental health and mental wellness, there are some separations, but I do believe the physical fitness can really help with the mental part of it.
Do you have, or did you have, any sort of a mental, sounds funny, mental, I don't know how to phrase it, mental fitness regimen similar to your physical fitness? You said four times a week was a must for you. Was there episode 6, we talked about meditation and maybe trying it and seeing if that can maybe give us some centeredness.
I'd say the best thing for my mental health through my career has been my wife. I mean, she's kept me grounded. She was a dispatcher for almost 30 years, and so she never had any trouble telling me where to go. but she was
well,
always
that work and at home.
Exactly. She was always great at keeping me grounded with as to one, what is important, kind of what, you know, focuses should be. And it was a great kind of, you know, checks and balance for me to be able to come home and have someone that really understood the profession, the job, and really what, you know, I was trying to achieve.
So that's a good transition then for me to ask my next question, which was, what have you done? And you just touched on a little bit, but what have you done, or what would you suggest to a new officer as tips for maybe mitigating that toll that it takes on the family? Because you have children too, right? They're grown now.
I do. Yes, they are.
They grew up with you in the job. What would you sit a young guy down and say, look, you're about to get married, you're going to have kids, here's what you need to do.
A couple things. I'll go back in time a little bit. I think our profession has totally screwed up taking care of our cops on the mental health side through the years. You know, in my early times as an officer, you would go through a traumatic incident and it was, you know, hit you on the shoulder, suck it up and go 10-8. You know, go back and go do your police work. And there was never really opportunities for employees to, you know, go see counseling, talk to other, you know, peer support wasn't even around when I was a young cop. And I saw in my agency probably a half a dozen of my friends that lost their job ultimately, whether it's through retirement, medical retirement, through losing their job because of the lack of support that agencies has provided. So we're still way behind as a profession, and we need to really do a lot better job. The good news is that the younger cops coming up, what I see is a more willingness to accept help more than the baby boomers like myself that, you know, I love riding a police car by myself. If I was given a partner for a day, hated it. It's the other way, it seems, with the younger generation. They love kind of partnering up. They're okay with seeking help or asking for guidance. And I think that that's great, and that will help them. So kind of a long-winded answer is my advice for young officers is don't wait too long. If you go through a critical incident, there's hundreds of people before you that have been through something similar that can help you get through it. They can show you or tell you what is to expect, what can happen, and don't be afraid to seek assistance. Hopefully, nowadays, most agencies have some type of EAP, counseling program, and at least resources that make it available for employees, and I highly encourage them to you know, accept that or seek it out. We need to do a better job, though, as a profession in this arena. And in California, you know, we have posts, and I was thinking about this actually on the way up here, knowing that I was going to talk to you. And, you know, we have we work so hard every 2 years on perishable skills, which we consider driving, defensive tactics, and shooting. Well, isn't fitness a perishable skill? And we don't talk about it. We don't deal with it. What do we do when you first come in to be a cop? We have you do a fitness test, right? We have you jump a wall. We have you do all kinds of running, jumping in the academy. They kick your butt and you're running all the best shape you're probably ever in is in the academy.
Absolutely.
And then we stop. And then we don't care anymore. We don't care as an agency. We don't care as a profession. And you have the guys driving that have that are overweight. And it hurts me when I see that, when I see officers that are overweight for them, because I know that I've had a great experience in my agency with two cops in particular that were overweight, probably about 40 to 50 pounds overweight, and both of them came to me and asked for some assistance. And so I did some programming for them, both of them lost significant amount of weight and actually are in really good shape now. And it's great to see and to hear them about what it's like wearing a uniform when you're 50 pounds overweight compared to now is amazing. And I mean, it really does make you feel good. And I would love that for everybody. And I think that, you know, until as a profession we make it a priority, it's going to be up to each individual cop. You know, you have to shoot once a quarter. Some people detac once a quarter, but what do you have to do other than, unless you make SWAT, you know, do a quarterly fit test. And, mm-hmm. You know, I think it is part of some of the changes that need to be made in this profession, quite frankly.
So when those two officers came to you, what were you chief at the time? Were you a captain?
I was I was a brand new chief, and we had just moved into our new building, so we had great equipment, some CrossFit equipment, we had treadmills, we had bikes, machines. We had fortunately, I was a project manager, and that was a key priority for me was making sure the gym was right. So I had offered it a couple times to employees. Matter of fact, there's a couple employees at our PD that are very much into CrossFit. And so we did kind of an intro night and said, hey, and I went through my level one cert back in 2009, I think it was. And so we offered, and a couple people slowly took us up on it. And so what I would do, at least for everybody who was interested, and they didn't have to come in with me, but just program on the wall. And we had whiteboards all over. And so I let, you know, the weightlifters use one part and whoever else use another part. And then we would take one part of the whiteboard and program every day. So we'd usually do a week at a time, because sometimes I couldn't get in there in the morning or whatever. But, and they seemed to love it. So
here's, I think, an important point for a lot of people that might be timid about asking for help, right? From your, it's hard to ask for help, and that's an ego kick to anybody. But to go above your rank and ask for help, I think intimidates a lot of people, and they think that the lieutenant or the chief or the captain is going to think less of me for asking for help. And I don't think that's the case. I think the majority of management is going to be appreciative of the self-awareness, but also see the proactiveness or the desire to change and look at that. Look at that as a positive aspect of that person.
You're right on. But here's what I realized when no one really cares what you do and cares about you when you're a captain. But it's when you become chief, all of a sudden it's like, you know, everyone wants to hear what you have to say. And I was just as dumb, you know, 2 weeks ago as I am now as a chief, right? So when I was just amazed at, and so it did have a huge impact on some of our officers, like secretly saying, hey, you mentioned that you would offer, but I really don't want other guys to see or, you know, other employees to see. Can we, you know, maybe just slip me a note of what a workout should be, text me, whatever. And, you know, I realized that, wow, it's, you know, I mean, we're our own worst enemy kind of with, we offer help, but they're afraid because they're afraid of what their peers may think of them if they go to a lieutenant or a captain or a chief. And so that's an unfortunate part of our business. But, you know, it does happen. So I had to figure out ways to work around that. And so I would, we had some sergeants and actually some officers too that were very good at CrossFit. So we'd kind of funnel some information through them and get it out that way, which made it work. And the other thing that became very interesting for me is, you know, when you're a captain and you're big into CrossFit, no one really cares. But when you become the chief, all of a sudden, you know, people want to say, oh, you know, if you don't do CrossFit, you are not going to get promoted or you're not going to do this. And that's just garbage. But that's, you know, it's in people's mindset that if you want to get in good with the chief, then you better, you know, don't be a runner, don't be this. And I used to tell them, all my employees all the time, I don't care if you do Pilates, I don't care if you walk, yoga, I care what you do, you just need to do something. Mm-hmm. And I'm a firm believer in, you know, CrossFit works for me, and I get it. It doesn't work for everybody.
Sure.
And, but for, you know, my DNA, it works great. And so people just need to find what's good for them. And the great thing about our department was we had a lot of different experts in certain areas. So I had a lieutenant and a sergeant that were very good runners, and they'd offer all the time to train people up. And so we had at one point, I think, 12 to 15 people did a half marathon.
Wow.
And so it was really a neat thing to see. And had a couple weightlifters that, you know, offered assistance. And so it wasn't just CrossFit, but that's what I always had to worry about, is that if the chief says this, and, you know, oh, it's now a mandate. And, but you deal with that with pretty much everything you do in when you're at that rank, because, you know, people believe it's the law when you say it. So you just have to be careful what you say.
Right. Well, you're being watched.
Right.
As much as
absolutely.
And that goes, any level of leadership, but
true.
As you go more, that pool expands.
Absolutely.
You know, we talk about leadership. I'd like to delve into that a little bit.
Sure.
You've held a lot of different ranks, from, you know, line level supervisor all the way up. What are the key lessons maybe you learned, or the things that you would want to impart? I mean, you have a successor, obviously. They didn't
right.
walk away with the chief. Were there if obviously he has experience, but if it were someone, okay, let's do it this way. I'm a sergeant. I just got promoted to your job for whatever I don't know how that happened. But
run.
What would you sit me down? What would you sit down and tell a new leader? Are you important at things?
Well, you know, leadership is a. I mean, we could probably have a whole podcast just talking
Absolutely,
about
yeah, yeah.
leadership. But I've always been, you know, a firm believer in decision making. Obviously, is very important, and I've, you know, studied some leadership as I've grown up in my career, and studied it either through, you know, academics or even just watching. And I think we can all pick immediately who is your worst supervisor. I mean, in a second, you could throw a name out right now. Don't do it, because they may be listening, right? I don't want you to do it, Garrett, and get in trouble.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
But, and then when you ask, what is it that you didn't like about that leader? You know, things like they didn't care. You know, they were, you know, a jerk. They only cared about themselves. And so when you talk about good leadership, and I do this all the time. I teach a couple classes, university classes on management and leadership. And when I ask them to think, okay, who's your best supervisor? Sometimes that takes a little bit, which is sad. But, and then when you talk about the things that make a good leader, it's usually compassion, caring, you know, things that don't really have anything to do with our job. It's how we do and treat people. And so, regardless if you're a sergeant, you know, lieutenant, captain, chief, it doesn't really matter. You have to really care about the organization and the position that you're in. Kind of one of the things I used to talk to my staff about is, don't make decisions for you, make it for the agency. And, you know, I'm love sports, and I've always been big into sports, and kind of the big thing for you know, one of the sports sayings is, you know, don't play for the name on the back of your jersey, play for the one that's on the front of your jersey. And that to me is really the essence of good leadership and supervision, that if you make all your decisions based on that, that you care what's in the good of the agency, usually you'll do pretty well. It's when you start thinking about what's in it for me. And, you know, we mentioned earlier about, you know, people watching more and more. The higher you go up the ranks, the more scrutiny that employees put on you and watch you. Oh, he did this or she did that. Or
and the public, I might interject.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And when you become chief, trust me, there's all kinds of targets, you know, and people watching you. And it's within your agency. It's, you know, the community. It's politicians, other city departments. And so you really have to not give those individuals ammunition. And whenever, if you look at anything that's gone wrong in our business, it's usually the decisions that were made in the best interest of that person, not the organization, in most cases. And so, you know, when new supervisors come to me all the time and say, hey, you know, I want to be a sergeant. And my first question is, why? And I usually get that blank look like, well, it's more money. but when we kind of delve down into why, it's like, well, you know, I think I can help. And, you know, the whole mentoring and developing is a key part of what we do. But you're working for that agency. You're a piece of that supervision puzzle. And if you look at a lot of the critical incidents that happen throughout that usually go bad for law enforcement, there's a lack of supervision. Someone didn't do their job somewhere, whether it's a sergeant, lieutenant, could be the chief or the captain. Someone messed up and they did not do a very good job because, again, the decisions that were made typically weren't in the best interest of the agency or the city. And, you know, to me, that is really one of the keys to good supervision. Now, there's a lot of other things, obviously, that make you in your decision-making style, your, you know, how you get along with people. You have to be, as a supervisor, and as you work your way up, it gets worse and worse, but like a chameleon, I mean, I can't treat, if I'm your supervisor, I can't treat you the same way I do the person that's sitting in the chair next to you at briefing.
Sure.
Because you respond differently to commands, to instructions. And so you have to start, you have to, you know, almost like you're a sociologist, you have to learn everyone's little idiosyncrasies and you have to care. And if you can do all that, then you can kind of navigate through the, you know, leadership roles. It's unfortunate though, in our profession, I think we lack a lot of really good leaders. And, you know, I don't know what the answer is, but a lot of it is probably on our testing processes for the positions. I think that lacks, and is, you know, we go so much by book knowledge, and it's not about book knowledge. It's you know, kind of in the heart, if you will, and need to figure out how to test for that, I guess. So.
That's, yeah. On the point you just made, too, I had a senior deputy, or equivalent of like a corporal, come to me recently, and I told him kind of what you said, was that you can't treat everyone equally. And he didn't understand what that meant. And I said, you have to treat them all fairly,
right,
but you can't treat them equally. I can't talk to my 18-year veteran the same way that I would a brand new rookie who just finished the academy, and also expect the same things from them in terms of their competency.
Right.
So you have to treat them fairly in terms of what they do, but not necessarily equally. And to me, there seems to be a real reluctance to mentorship. And I think that maybe that's fear due to the civil service system. Seems like, oh, we can't show favorites, and mentoring is a favorites thing because now Johnny's our guy.
Right.
But yeah, I would love to find a way to implement more of that, and for people coming up, but also just for my sake as a frontline guy going like, hey, I have this situation I've never encountered before. You know, how would you suggest it?
Right.
You know, there are those people out there, of course, but some formalized system for people would be
great. And I agree that's it's key, that because most of the situations as young supervisors, and really in any position, get handed, someone's dealt with that before. And so you need to figure out a system within an agency that allows, makes it okay to go seek assistance and to go seek help without thinking, oh, you're jumping the chain of command, or, you know, you're just trying to kiss up for the next promotion, mm-hmm. or, you know, whatever ridiculous things that we think of sometimes in our business. And it's key that we help develop, especially the good leaders, help develop other new good leaders. And there is, it is difficult, because how do you spend a lot of time with one person? Maybe you see they have great qualities, but as you said, if you spend a lot of time with them, what's the kickback going to be? It's going to be, oh, that's Garrett's guy. Mm-hmm. You know, it's his boy. No wonder he got promoted. And so right. It's a double-edged sword, because we in our profession are clearly our own worst enemies.
Yes, we are. Did your leadership style change at all, or did it have to change as you went up?
Yeah, it definitely did. And I look back now at like some decisions or things on how I supervised as a sergeant or lieutenant. I'm like, ooh, that wasn't that good. And it is, you know, I hate to use this, but I'm going to use it anyways. But when they talk about the big picture, right? When you hear supervisors or maybe someone cap, hey, you don't see the big picture. It is true. And what I try to explain to my staff, so sergeants, lieutenants, captains, is that as a sergeant, think of that big picture as just a small, you know, it's almost like one slice of pie. You have your squad, you're dealing with your issues. And then as a lieutenant, you typically have two squads, you know, two or three sometimes. And so your vision has expanded a little bit more. And then as a captain, you typically have half the pie, because you'll have one division or the other, depending on how big your agency is or divisions. And so you're going to see a little bit more. And then as a chief, you not only get to deal with the pie of the agency, you get to deal with the pie of the community and the politicians. And so how I do things or did things as a chief, I looked back at some of the things that I did as a young sergeant or young lieutenant and go, okay. And it has helped me to try to teach or mentor other people. One of the big things, especially as a new supervisor, is this, you know, buddy to boss. I worked in a squad that I was very good friends with everyone on my squad. We all worked together for 4 years, and then I got promoted and got put in charge of that squad. And I think about some of the things I did back then. I'm like, you know, it probably wasn't the best supervision, but it happens. And so we have to figure out how to, you know, navigate through some of those difficult things. And then as a lieutenant, you're now in management, and that's a whole nother set of issues that you have to deal with, because you're, and I don't mean this disparagingly, but you're almost like a misfit, because you're not one of the guys with the sergeants right. and with the patrol officers, and you're not really one of the guys with the upper management. And so you're kind of trying to figure out your way and navigating in between that. And so it can be a difficult transition for a lot of sergeants. So
to me, it seems too that followership is a big part of leadership.
Absolutely. I mean,
on both sides. So from my level, followership in the sense of doing what is best for the agency and not best for me, but also I may disagree with the path that we're taking, but to get the buy-in from the squad, I need to demonstrate that I'm committed to it regardless.
Right.
And that goes all the way up. I mean, like, how as the chief, though, do you kind of instill that followership down?
So it's kind of goes back to what we talked about with, you know, my supervision decisions as a younger. I realize now, as a younger cop or supervisor, why some of the decisions were made that were made that I didn't understand back then. I thought we're all screwed up just like everyone else does, right? But as you now have the full picture, it's like, okay, well, that makes sense. You know, mm-hmm. why they did what they did back then. And so what I tried to do with decision making, and when I made a decision that sometimes wasn't so popular, is one of the groups I had in our department was a chief's advisory committee, which was all just line level employees, no supervision. And so when there was one of these things that we would meet, and I'd say, hey, here's why we did what we did. here's how the process, you know, it wasn't made in a vacuum. We didn't flip a coin, you know, we didn't go through the alphabet, you know, things like that.
The top three, but, top three reasons Lion thinks that you did something.
Exactly. And so I would at least be able to not only answer their questions, but give them reasons why decisions were made. And then they would go then and kind of, in their own way, regurgitate that to all the employees. And it seemed to work out pretty well for me in our agency. And it was a good way to really get information out there and to at least give people that understanding of why a decision was made.
I like that. I don't think I've heard of that before. I'm sure it exists. I just haven't heard of it before. Where there's
Yeah, it's, you know, I'm a genius clearly and thought of it myself. So.
I was getting to that. We have the equivalent of ours is our SWAT team.
Okay.
I guess because they will usually go into them and because you know it's a large group,
right?
And say, hey, go tell everybody else,
right?
And so they go off and say,
nice.
I guess it works.
Yeah,
it works all right. So retired now for a little bit,
correct?
Out traveling around. I mean, you're up here visiting for the night anyway,
right?
Giving you time to reconnect, I imagine, and do some of those things you mentioned with family and friends. What are your priorities now?
Well, a couple actually is fitness is still a very high priority. I mean, I work out usually every morning, and
you still go to a box?
I do.
Yeah, you want to give a shout out?
CrossFit East County,
okay,
in El Cajon. Paul Flores is the owner there. We've gone to three different gyms now. We started out a little strip mall and then went to a bigger box. Now it's like, I don't know, 8,000 square feet.
Holy cow. It's
huge. But probably one of the best trainers as far as CrossFit goes, just very patient and very good himself. Mm-hmm. And it's been just a joy to work with. So that it's a huge priority. Usually work out in the mornings and brought, even on this trip in the motorhome, brought a kettlebell and an ab mat and my jump ropes. And so, you know, it's no matter where I'm at, can easily do a decent workout with that equipment.
I think the hardest thing about working out in San Diego for me would be that you're surrounded by all the best West Coast IPA.
That's true.
You've got a lot of good stuff in Escondido and Stone.
So a lot of the things we do is we'll just bring a cooler beer to the gym. So
yeah,
that way no one's, you know, and then you just have a beer after your workout.
There you go. That's great. And now you're doing something with RX called the Donuts and Double Unders Tour. What is that?
I like the name. Dave Newman, the owner.
Donuts for Double Unders.
Right. Dave Newman, the owner, came up with that one. Actually, he sent out because God knows I have no idea what a Twitter is or Facebook or any of those things. But he sent, when I agreed to come and do some training for him, sent out a tweet, I guess, and or an Instagram also, and said that I was going to do this Donuts for Double Unders Tour. And his kind of idea was to just travel around to law enforcement gyms, mm-hmm, and provide any type of double under training or any type of training that they needed or equipment, and kind of work my way through the country. So we're slowly going to start that. I've been doing my own traveling the last few months, and so probably September, October, we'll start doing some of that. I've actually been in contact with IACP to maybe do some wellness stuff for them as well.
International Association of Chiefs Police.
Right? Correct. Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah. And there are conferences in October in Chicago, so we may do something up there. I've been to a couple of law enforcement gyms. We were up at L.A. Sheriff's, their Special Enforcement Bureau, their SWAT team. They had a competition up there 2 weekends ago, and so we went up and supported them. The Newmans who run RX are very pro law enforcement, and anything that they can do to help out this profession is really important to them. And so they've kind of sent me on that quest to see what people need and to see what they want. And so they do kind of what we do, or the business does, is goes out and does 2-hour double under clinics. So teach people kind of the fundamental basics of how to do a double under, because it's obviously a very technical exercise in CrossFit. And so And it's probably one of the few things I've actually figured out how to do. And it took a while, but figured it out. And so it's a lot of fun to go out and teach people and to see kind of things click in their head and just give them some real basic instruction on how to do double under. And then a lot of it afterwards is practice for them. But you get to see a lot of PRs for people when we're doing the clinics. And so my goal is... towards the latter end of this year is to start figuring out what law enforcement gyms are interested and just start working our way through the country. And
you'll have to come back up here because I can't get a double under.
You can't. Okay,
I think my PR is like then. 8.
Well, you'll have to twist my arm to come back to Santa Barbara because it's really it's so tough.
But
over
a free plug for RX. I didn't get that. I didn't even get 8 until I got an RX.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
So that
nice.
Helped a lot. And very that's just an honest
now,
plug
it's a,
there.
It is a it's I tell you what's talk about RX just for a little bit. What's been so cool for me is that Dave came up with this whole idea. We all bought jump ropes, and this is 7 or 8 years ago, bought jump ropes at Sports Authority or Big Five. And he figured out that if you could, he'd break the handle open and then just messed and put some ball bearings and little washers inside the handle, it would make it spin faster. And that's really how he kind of came up with this whole concept of developing the RX jump rope. And so he tweaked all of ours in the gym early on, you know, like I say, about 7 years ago. And then he started ordering parts from all over and kind of actually putting them together. And it's developed through the years. But now, I mean, it's ridiculous how many, I mean, he has a full warehouse with probably 25 employees and, you know, RX is all over the place.
Yeah.
With they went to every regional event, even one in Australia and Denmark. And so it's great to see his business go from literally the back of his truck at the gym to his living room to now, you know, a big warehouse. And they're great people. So it's been fun to be a little bit a part of it and now hopefully be a little bigger part of it.
And yeah. In fact, there's a guy I really hope to get on the show is an RX sponsored athlete is John Pera.
Oh, John's a great guy.
Who just finished the games
right.
And is a full-time LA deputy sheriff.
Correct.
And he killed it out there.
Yeah.
I just blown away. I honestly didn't know who he was. I'd seen his photos and all the RX gear, but I didn't know he was a cop until this year. And watching what he did and so I got to get him on and maybe I was just like how does he do that? How he's got I think he's got 2 kids. He's
correct.
Married, and he does, like, he finished regionals, his wife, or somebody posted something, he finished regionals, and then went to work the next day and did a 16-hour shift.
Yeah, he is an amazing athlete. I've had the great opportunity to meet him a couple times, and it was a lot of fun seeing him compete over the weekend. It is amazing. Matter of fact, he was at the RX facility probably a month or two ago doing a photo shoot, and... showing off all of his muscles that he has. And I was talking to him about, I'm like, how do you do it? And, you know, part of what he works in the jails, which makes it a little bit easier right now.
Mm-hmm.
And, but still, I mean, it, you know, you're working, like you say, 12, 16 hour shifts in the jails. And then, you know, trust me, these guys work more than, you know, work out more than 1 hour a day.
Oh, yeah.
So, It is really cool. I think it's great for the profession.
Absolutely.
To see. And he came up when I went to the LA Sheriff's SWAT competition. He came out there to support. And so it was really neat to see also all the LA Sheriff's guys, you know, kind of rally around him as well. And,
sure.
You know, really is, and he's a great guy, a great family. And I know that RX is proud to sponsor him, and he's definitely a great role model for a lot of us.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, he went to the top of the heap when I just learned all that about him.
Right.
Because again, I was like flabbergasted, like how?
Right.
I got 2 kids too, but I can't seem to get it right.
Yeah.
But he does. Like, why not?
Exactly.
I'm relatively intelligent, kind of anyway. So I have 2 questions left before I let you get back to your vacation. You mentioned working out in the mornings. Do you have a morning routine other than working out, or is that just it? And also, do you have a nighttime routine?
So typically my morning routine is whatever the prescribed workout happens to be at the gym. It's usually I go in at 8 a.m. And then the evenings right now, it's really all about family. And we hang out and go do stuff. My daughter just finished college, and so she's living with us still. And so my wife and I and her usually palling around together, doing all kinds of fun stuff and doing some traveling. And my other daughter is a school teacher in Milwaukee. And she has, during the summer, she was off, so we got to spend a week. We all went to Hawaii together.
Oh, nice.
It was a lot of fun. But no real routine per se. People ask me all the time, what do you do during the day? And I'm like, I don't know. I wake up, work out, and the day's over by the time I know it. But
that attention to your fitness is there every day.
Absolutely.
And it's still there.
Yeah.
Another question I like to ask people sometimes, and we didn't talk about this at all, but I'm just always curious what books people are reading or that people have read or maybe a book that you've gifted to some of your the people you've worked with.
There's a few of them. Right now I'm reading some just fiction stuff just because it's fun to just kind of get away, just some. I've actually got hooked a little bit on the I'm on Killing Patton right now. Mm-hmm. Can't remember his name.
Bill O'Reilly, right?
Bill O'Reilly, yeah. And so I've read the other. I just read Killing Jesus and Killing Kennedy and Killing Lincoln, and so very interesting historical perspectives from their research. And I'm trying to think of some of the books that I've handed down. But as typically happens when you retire, my mind's going completely blank. So.
Well, you're on vacation too.
Yeah. I'm on an eternal vacation.
That's nice.
Yeah.
That sounds nice.
Definitely.
Thank you, Ed, for your time. Appreciate this. I think a lot of great information and just discussion on the importance of being committed to it throughout your career. You're a great example of doing that. I mentioned John Pera as a guy who's like, wow, how does he do that? And I think he's younger than me, but at the same time, I have a foot in both worlds of seeing the end of my career reasonably in sight, and I don't want to end up broken and battered. And you're a good role model for that as well. So thank you.
No, I appreciate it. I was honored to even be asked to do this. And as we were driving up here, my wife turned to me and said, why the hell does he want to talk to you? I said, I don't know. He's obviously ran out of
episode 11. He's already out of ideas.
Exactly.
No, not at all.
It was an honor to do this, and I'm glad we were able to work it out. And anything I can do for you personally, your agency, or any of the people that are listening, please let me know. I have an easy email. It's ed@rxsmartgear.com. And if you need anything, or if you need anything through RX or anything at all, or just want to talk fitness, give me a buzz.
Excellent. I'll make sure that we put all that in the show notes too.
Okay.
And we'll put links to those books you just mentioned and some of the other things we talked about there as well. All right. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Garrett. Appreciate it.